Good morning, everybody, and welcome to a misty African dawn here in the Kruger National Park. My name is James Hendry. On camera today is Viam, and his white-gloved hand. He looks like a waiter about to serve me breakfast, which is unfortunately not what's about to happen. Now, you're on a live safari if you're wondering who this fellow blethering at you out of the mist is, and that means you must talk to us, please, over the course of the next 3 hours. Hashtag Safari Live, questions at wildearth.tv. A cold front blew in sometime during the course of the night, and it has covered the low veld, that is the low-lying areas of South Africa that we find ourselves in, about 450 metres above sea level, in a sort of eerie mist. Now, on the other vehicle, we've got Byron Sarau. He is joining us for his last two drives, unfortunately, at this particular stint of his existence here. He is being filmed by the very tall figure of Brian the Thumb Joubert. In the final control, Rebecca Christensen of Denmark and Louise Pavid of, Johannesburg is helping her out. You are all most welcome. You, of course, are the most important part of what we're going to be doing this afternoon, and so please do talk to us. We're going to head off towards Cheetah Plains, which is in the deep east. Into that mist, we're going to bravely forge, hoping to see what we can find there. I don't know what we're going to find. The lions seem to have moved off. Perhaps they'll be found again. Byron is heading towards where Karula was. She's our famous queen, 12-year-old female leopard, with George and Charlotte, her two young cubs, and with any luck he'll find them. So that's the plan for the morning. I think the temperature is probably around about 12 or 13 degrees Celsius. It's around about 54 to 56 degrees Fahrenheit. And that is all I have to tell you for the moment. Let's go and find some animals. I'm just going to re-put my gloves on. All right. There we go. Let's go to Byron and see if he's found the leopard.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome again to Safari Live. My name is Byron, and with me on camera this morning is Brian. Morning, Brian.
How's it?
And the thumb. Oh, yeah. Just to make sure we've got everything sorted behind us here. We're in the spot where Karula was yesterday with the two little cubs. I'm having a look now. It doesn't seem like she is here. Perhaps she has moved on. It was a very small kill that she made yesterday, a small dika, and that's a substantial meal for a leopard, but when she's got two little cubs to feed, it can often get finished a lot sooner than if it was just her by herself. I'm trying to have a look. I saw a lot of hyena tracks heading into this area as we approached, so potentially what may have happened is, with these cubs, you know, they climb in and out of the tree and they try and tear pieces of meat. They'll often knock a kill out of the tree. And by doing that, if there was an opportunistic hyena around, the hyena could possibly have stolen it. But I'm just going to look carefully around here. You never know. She could have hung around in this area, or maybe she went to go and have a drink of water. We'll try to check carefully before we leave. Let's make sure we don't miss anything. We had a very exciting day yesterday. We had lions, we had wild dog, we had the leopard, and then those lions roaring at the end of the show, which was amazing. One of my favorite sounds. I want to check this drainage line carefully. I really do not see any sign of a leopard around here. Also, if there was hyena activity, Brian is scanning there for us now, but if there was hyena activity around here last night, then the chances of the female hanging around with the cubs are highly unlikely. She would prefer to take them and get them out of the area. You know, even those cubs are able to climb and get out of the reach of predators like hyena. If they accidentally slip or fall out of the tree or get caught unawares, those hyena will kill the cubs. So that female leopard will be very careful protecting those cubs and trying to get them out of the area as quickly as possible if the kill is finished. There's no need for her to hang around. So I think let us move out back towards the road. We'll have a good look and see if we can't find any tracks of them. So Matt in New York has asked us, are there any animals that we don't get during the winter or cold seasons? Animals that may potentially hibernate. So Matt, we don't have animals like you get in the United States, like bears and that hibernate, but other animals like snakes, a lot of the reptiles will hibernate. They don't like the cold very much. So yes, I suppose they do hibernate. But we don't have mammals that hibernate in southern Africa that we don't see. Just making sure I don't miss anything while we're driving out here. James was very lucky with seeing the cubs yesterday. Spent most of the day with them and the whole afternoon drive, which was really, really great. It's very, very special to be able to see leopard cubs. You know, a leopard is such an elusive cat. And for that female to be very relaxed with the vehicles around her and happy to show us her cubs is really a privilege. Fantastic to be able to see them. So Siberia Zumi has asked us, what is the most resilient animal which occurs in this area and the most resilient animal to deal with change in temperature? So Siberian Zumi, the thing is in this area, you know, the temperature doesn't really drop massively like you get in North America or Northern Europe where you have snow and extreme cold conditions. Yes, it gets cold, but it's not a massive temperature difference where you get extreme cold or extreme heat. So the temperature drops, but all the animals with having fur on them, they adapt very easily to these cold conditions. So it's not something that would cause them to really, really suffer in the cold months. It's not that cold. Yes, we look bundled up in that, but it's because we can't handle the cold like they can. But all the animals are resilient to the temperature change. They have all adapted to suit their surroundings. And this area, all the animals are very comfortable, whether it be winter or summer. Just going to chat with Lex here quickly. Morning, Lex. How are you? See, good, thank you. So, I've had a look there, no sign of her. I saw some hyena tracks, I'm not sure, potentially she dropped the kill and they stole it. I don't walk through there yet. I'm just going to try to check around, maybe if they've got tracks coming out.
Okay. I think I might do the same. I'll also go in and have a check. And then
okay. All right, great. See you later. Enjoy. See, it helps for us to chat to other guides in the area and just update each other and let them know exactly what we're doing. And we can work together as a team, you know. One guy will check one area and another guide will check another area. And hopefully we can work together to find whatever it is we're looking for, especially when it comes to tracking. So, good morning to Caroline, who is a new viewer. So, Caroline, you are on a live safari in the middle of South Africa. We are in the northeastern part of South Africa, in the Greater Kruger National Park, in an area known as Juma Game Reserve, which is in the Sabi Sands. It's a private part of Kruger, or the Greater Kruger.
And what we are doing is taking viewers from all over the world on safari. So what we see, and as it happens, is what you see back home. Which is really, really great. At the moment, we're looking for a leopard and two cubs. But no luck just yet. They were seen yesterday. Yesterday morning and yesterday afternoon. And it looks like they've moved off. But I think because they had a kill, they potentially have finished the kill. So at the moment, we're just scanning through the area and trying to see if we can't find any tracks of this leopard and her cubs. And Caroline, while you are watching, you can ask us questions at hashtag Safari Live. Or email us questions at wildearth.tv. And your questions will come straight through to us. We'll be able to answer any other questions for you. John has asked us, what drive do I prefer? The morning drive or the afternoon drive? John, it's very difficult. I think both are great. I love the early mornings, especially in winter. The crisp early mornings. I really do enjoy it, and as it's not, the days start to warm up, I think in winter they're probably my favorite. And then I think the afternoon drives are great too. And yesterday we were very lucky, we had great afternoon drives. You'll notice I'm looking off the edge of the vehicle while I'm driving. I just want to make sure that I don't miss any tracks, but it is very difficult at times to try and see a little leopard track, which is not very big, only about that large. If you can see, there we go. And if you're not watching very carefully, it is difficult. It is still quite cool this morning, so a lot of the animals do stay hunkered down and rest in this cold weather until the sun rises and starts to warm up a little bit. Then you get more animals moving around, a little bit more activity. Even the predators, who are generally nocturnal, move around a lot at night and early mornings. When it's cold like this, this just before sunrise or sunrise, the temperature drops quite a bit. I thought I heard something. So Anne in Canada has asked us, are there any animals which migrate in this area because they don't hibernate? No, and not in southern Africa at all. There are no migrations down here. Migrations in Africa are generally not due to temperature change. It's mostly due to water and food change. You get a lot of migrations up in East Africa, in Kenya and Tanzania. Down here in Southern Africa, there is still a constant amount of water, even though the dry seasons do occur. Some rivers do still hold water, so the animals do not migrate. You might get seasonal movements through smaller areas, but they don't necessarily migrate out of the country or cross borders into areas that have more food or more water. So not down here, no. But East Africa, yes. While I continue my search for the leopard, James has got some large grey animals for you to look at.
Now that large grey animal over there, everybody, has got a seriously impressive little rack of tusks for such a small elephant. I think he's going to be a very, very large tusker one day. Youngster. Probably only about, I don't know, about 9 years old maybe. And already got very impressive tusks. Right, we're halfway sort of between Juma and Cheetah Plains. We've just stopped here to enjoy a bit of dawn elephant action. And there, a they walk. I'm just looking. Yeah, that's. I'm 90% sure that's a young bull. And in the background, I think another young bull. And there's a whole herd feeding off behind us. And you may just be able to pick up the odd grey shape. You'll see one there, just in the back of your picture. There's a grey dawn shape. Almost ghostly, ghost-like, walking through the misty woodland. This young chap is being particularly confiding about life. Isn't he great? He's very young now. He's not coming here to find something to eat. He's almost certainly wandering over here because he's just quite interested in what we're doing. Just having a look and a listen and a smell. And you see him sort of feeling out the plants. And every so often he just turns the end of his nose towards us. That's his trunk, of course. Just decides as a smell to see if we are a threat, maybe. Or just to see if he can pick up anything that's interests him smell-wise. Hugely important, of course, the sense of smell, the olfactory communication. Here we go. Now, the good news, everybody, while we sit here, I must just tell you, is that Karula has been found. I'm sure Byron will get there. That's interesting, is that I said to VM halfway down Twin Dams Road, I said maybe we should just go across and check the other road there, and then we didn't. Anyway, she's popped out onto Philemon's Dip. She's heading south, which seems to be her sort of natural movement at the moment after she's had a kill up here. So that's great. With any luck, you'll be with two little cubbies very soon. Sorry, Elaine, I've missed your question. There was a lot going on the Game Drive channel. Elaine Cole, you've asked a question. I'm going to ask Rebecca to read it back to me. You want to know if the lions here have ever killed any elephants, Elaine? Elaine, not as far as I know, not an adult elephant. I know hyenas killed a crippled 4-year-old elephant not too long ago. I've no doubt that there must be a record or two of a sort of seriously starving elephant being killed by lions in this area, but it's very uncommon. It does happen in Savuti, and that's because, of course, they have an extended dry season there with very sparsely distributed water, and the elephants really do lose an enormous amount of condition over the course of the dry season. And the water is so concentrated that the lions just lurk around the water holes, knowing that eventually very thirsty animals are going to have to come and drink. And what they do then is prey on the young and very vulnerable elephants. Sometimes fully grown cows will be taken, but they have to be pretty weakened for an elephant to be able to take them. A question from someone called the Gremlins General. Hello, Gremlins General. You want to know if elephants migrate? Elephants do not migrate, Gremlins General. And you want to know if they're territorial? They are not territorial. They are what we call, they have home ranges, so they have an area in which they move, but they do not defend it. They do not mark a territory. And so, yeah, not territorial at all. But that home range can be massive, or it can be very small, depending on the number of resources that there are in an area. And so while elephants can migrate, they can move vast distances between feeding grounds. If there is sufficient food in one area, they'll normally hang around. Water as well. Water, an extremely important limiting nutrient for elephants. And in this area, you know, there's a lot of artificial pumping of water, and so elephants are never really that short of water, so it doesn't occur like a dozen Savuti, where these sort of water-starved elephants try desperately to find water all the time. Very nice, enormous flatulence there. And James from Michigan, a very nice question from you about what are they going to eat in these very dry conditions. James, well, you can see there that they are eating the last of the green trees. There are a couple of evergreens that they will eat during the course of the dry season. We're almost into July now, which generally means that, you know, we've got 2 months left before the trees start to sprout. So they will move increasingly on to eating the bark of trees. So they'll break off big branches and they'll chew off the outer bark, which has got some nutritious vascular tissue inside it. That's what they'll eat there. They'll pick up the odd bit of dry leaves. They'll also try and find seed pods that have been dropped on the ground and left there. But it's going to be largely bark and twigs and roots. So they'll dig up, you see the tree he's eating there, it's called a cumbritum. Looks like a Cumbritum calinum, or large, not large fruited, variable bush willow. And they, you can see it's broken. And what he will probably do is eventually dig out the roots. So he'll eat the bark at the moment. He'll sample the leaves. They're not a huge fan of the leaves. And then he'll start to dig out the roots, which are repositories for nutritious stuff. Lovely colours there. Aqua, interesting one from you. You say, do I think that the elephant's trunk evolved as a result of the digestive system, or do I think the digestive system evolved as a result of the trunk? Aqua, nothing about that animal evolved in isolation or as a response to something else that evolved about that animal. They will all, everything, all characteristics would have evolved together for it to exploit the, largely I suppose, the trophic or food niche that it needed to fulfill, or that was open, and that's basically what has happened there. And so I don't think that the, you know, it evolved from the same, eventually the same ancestors as the other hindgut fermenting animals, like zebras and pigs. And you will find, I think, that the trunk was simply an evolutionary adaptation to reaching different foods and reaching a great suite of different kinds of foods, fruits, and being able to pick up individual leaves, and of course to drinking and defense. And it also meant that the neck didn't have to be very long, because of course you know that many animals have to be able to reach down to the ground, and that puts a huge strain of course on the back. And if you're that big to have to do that, the muscles involved would have been enormous. Much more interesting, or much a cleverer adaptation if you like, to just have a long muscular protuberance from the front of your face, which I'm glad I don't have. Right, let's leave these fellows and start heading.
Oh, it's the lens misted up.
No, the lens is okay. Oh, apparently it is a little bit misted up. Oh, there we go. Well done. Marsha, we're going to move on slowly here because these elephants are feeding into the woodland. You want to know how it is that the tusks get longer, at least get rounder. You can see how they get longer but not rounder. Marsha, in the same way that a tree trunk, I suppose, well, not quite the same way, gets longer and rounder. The base just gets wider, so I mean the tusks come out, erupt from the skull just below the nose. They are the two front teeth. And as the animal gets bigger, so, you know, there are two growth points. One that sends the tusk out longer, and obviously one that makes it wider at the base. Because it couldn't, obviously, if it was very thin and very long, it would make it very brittle. Is that the answer you're looking for? If not, please let me know and I'll try and do a better job. I'm going to try and get you a nice look at the sun. Hello, Virginia. Virginia, you want to know if elephants ever replace their tusks. So you know that they're molars. They get six sets of molars in the back and then the top. And you want to know if they ever replace their tusks. No, the tusks are one-off. And once they come out, that's it. You don't get another tusk. Let's head across to Byron. He's on the search for Karula. She is quite close by. I think she's moving south. So hopefully you'll get a glimpse of her before she disappears.
Yes, we are in search of Karula. We've heard Impala alarm calling and we think she's in this area, just moving down towards this drainage line. There's another vehicle here too. Keep your eyes peeled. It's very exciting. Let's see what we can find. Just having a good look here. There she is, there she is. Right up at the top there. There we go. Fantastic, we've found her. That is awesome, awesome. And we only knew that she was in this area because we heard those Impala alarm calling. So Lex heard them first and he let us know. He came looking straight into this, or came into this area. There is a cub I can see that is not far behind her, just hiding in the thicket. Might be able to see it shortly. There's a little bit of movement. There we go. Look at that, everybody. There's the one cub. Fantastic. That is really, really beautiful. Oh, no, this is amazing. This is my first time to see Karula and her cubs. So excited. So we're actually quite far from where they had that kill yesterday. It just shows you they can move a lot if they want to. And I think it's exactly what happened. There was no sign of that kill anywhere. I think they must have dropped it and hyena scavenged and stole what was left. And then she decided to take the cubs out of that area. Oh, she's a beautiful, beautiful female. Oh, there's the other cub. Oh, fantastic, both of them. Right out there. That looks like a young male. Just saw. So she has a young male and a young female. Two very, very beautiful cubs. They're about 5 months or almost 5 months old. To my understanding, I was chatting to James about her last night. Beautiful 12, almost 13-year-old leopard. So she's still in her prime. She's got a few more years to look forward to, and she's obviously doing very well and being very successful having these two cubs. It's not always easy. Oh, look at that face. It's not easy to raise cubs for leopard. So James Taylor has just asked us, are the cubs only eating meat? No, James, not necessarily. They possibly are still trying to suckle a little bit, but I don't think that female will allow them to suckle for too much longer. I haven't really seen if they are still suckling, but they try their luck. You know, 3-4 months old, they still try their luck and try and suckle a bit from their mother. But probably mostly just feeding on meat at the moment, and she will start taking them to water holes and allow them to drink. So there might still be a small chance that they get a little bit of milk for her, from her, but generally they would be feeding purely on meat at this age. 5 months, yeah, I would say they're completely feeding on meat now. They start feeding on meat from quite a young age. She may have heard something. Often what these leopards do is, especially now these early mornings, it's very, very cool. Just trying to see where she goes. I can just get a glimpse of her moving every now and then through the thicket, hoping she decides to come down into this drainage line where we are. She may also just move along the edge of the bank. There's still the one cub. Yeah, I can see her. She's moving along the edge of this drainage line. We're a little bit lower down at the moment. You can see how thick it is here. This is perfect, a perfect area for these leopard. You know, we heard those impala alarm calling at her earlier, and when we saw the impala, it was in a little bit of an open area. So that's not ideal for leopard, especially with the cubs. She would like to stay. I caught a glimpse of her moving again. She would like to stay as hidden as possible. Just give me a second. I just want to see which direction she goes. See if we can't get another glimpse of her, and then we'll move. Try to follow her around. Anna Marie, I'm also very, very happy that I managed to see the royal cubs. Copy, thanks. Yeah, got a visual. I think we're going to stay down here for now, Alex. We'll move around. Just keep me updated. Thank you. She's moving along this drainage line. It's always difficult now to decide where we're going to go. Is she going to come down into this area? Is she going to stay walking on the other side? It's not always easy to predict where these animals are going to walk. But it is such a privilege to be able to see a female leopard like this with her cubs, especially on the move. Because you can see how difficult it is to find them in this thick bush that they like moving through. Oh, and what a beautiful morning. This mist, I know James touched on it earlier. It's sunrise, the mist, it's really, really amazing. We're so fortunate to be able to come out here and have a look around for these animals. One of the other vehicles, and Lex, who found Karula or alerted us that the impala were alarm calling in this direction. As we stopped to listen, we heard it too. We rushed over here, and it's quite, as I was saying, it's quite far from where the kill was. So she's probably moved through most of the evening or early this morning. Just want to scan and see if I can't see which direction she's going in. But look at this beautiful landscape, the trees, the eye, and the sunlight. So E.B. Murphy has asked just how far more or less they have traveled overnight. So I would guess probably from where the kill is, as the crow flies, I'm trying to think now, about at least a kilometer, I would say. I would say maybe 1.5 kilometers. So that's quite a distance from where she was. I think she may have gone past the waterhole. I understand our dam cam went down during the evening, so potentially she went past. I'm not 100% sure, but the direction from where the kill was to where we are now, it's directly across that line of the dam. So I think she must have left the kill, moved around, potentially gone to drink with the cubs, because when they do feed on any prey, they do get quite thirsty. Maybe had a drink and then moved off. And that's interesting. That's exactly the area where those two male lions were last night. But I think when we left them, they had started to move off. And I think she probably was clever enough to avoid them. They moved more in a southerly direction. And I think she came from across the dam and then down. We are now southwest, I would say, of where the dam is in that direction. Just trying to see now. Okay, it looks like we've stopped. No, they're moving again. I'm just watching one of the other vehicles. You can just get a glimpse of her moving through the thicket every now and then. It's quite thick down there, so I don't think it'll be very easy for us to get down there. The other thing is, when you're following these predators, I find it often helps just to be a bit patient and see which direction they are going, and inevitably they are going to come out somewhere that might be easier to get to, as opposed to trying to just crash through the bush and get to see them. You know, we also have to be a little bit sensitive when we are following these animals, especially this female with the two young cubs. You know, we don't want to disturb them and cause them to be nervous of the vehicles at all, so we just being patient and sitting and waiting. See exactly which direction they go, and then we can hopefully plan that they come towards us if we stop up ahead. Just scanning again carefully. Just seeing if I can't get a glimpse of them, but it is very, very thick. Using binoculars at the moment makes it a bit easier. So well camouflaged, especially in this light. It's not easy to see them. But I don't want you to leave us just yet. I want you to stick around so that we can try and show you these cubs and this leopard again. Let me just have a look. There's a bit of an opening here. I'm driving quickly. Copy, Lex. I wonder if it's not worth my while trying to come across to that side rather. Copy. I suppose as I move, she may come this side, so I'll sit here a little bit longer and wait. Right, there we go. Brian has got it. Brian, your spotting is amazing. That camera work that Brian's able to do is incredible. He's got it, that's amazing. And affirmative, we have got a view of her. Thank you, Lex. Yeah, so. And see how she's scanning constantly. She could potentially be hunting. You know, leopards are just very opportunistic. Even though she ate very recently, whenever they're walking around, especially through these drainage lines, these thick areas, she's able to conceal herself very, very well. And she'll still be on the lookout for any potential prey. But look at that. She blends in so well. It's nice. Brian is a little bit higher than me. So with the camera, it's a bit easier to spot him. He's able to give you that great view. Don't see any sign of the cubs just yet, but they're obviously a little bit smaller. Wow, look at that sunlight on her face. So TM and Tolly has asked us, how can we tell the difference between a cheetah and a leopard? So TM, one of the main differences is the face. And a leopard has a very large round head with the pattern on a leopard is known as rosettes. So they don't have clear spots, even though further down the body and the stomach and that, you can see round spots, but on the body it is a rosette as opposed to a clear spot. I will show you in the book shortly. I just don't want us to take the camera off that leopard now. We've been trying very hard for a view of her, so while we can see her, let's just keep an eye on her. So Tim, the thing is, the leopards are slightly shorter cats, but they are very powerful, so they're very stocky. They've got a very muscular build, whereas the cheetah are slightly taller, a little bit more slender, and built for speed. And the cheetah have very clear spots on their body, and they've got on the face, if you look at the face, they've got clear black, what we call tear marks, that run from the eye all the way down around the face, or around the nose, down the face. The leopards do not have that. Leopards also have that very beautiful, looks almost like a necklace, a stripe of black markings around the neck. Do you see that? You can actually see it on the female. And they prefer different habitat. Leopard prefer thicker areas, whereas cheetah, especially because of their hunting style, they run down their prey and use their speed. They prefer more open areas. I hope that answers your question a little bit better. I would like to show you in the book, but I will show you in the book a little bit later. So wonderful and peaceful. It's great just to sit here and watch this leopard. You know, often in situations like this, and when I do guide guests, it's just nice to sit peacefully and watch and see how she reacts to the sounds and the smells and everything she can pick up that we might miss. But she's constantly on the lookout. You see how alert she is. We've got some scrub robins calling in the distance, some starlings. It's a very, very beautiful morning. Looks like that female is sitting right on top of a termite mound. And they will use termite mounds, especially termite mounds, for a vantage point. It gives a raised elevation. She may look around, just as she is doing now. Just want to see, Brian, if you don't mind, let me just try to see if I can reposition us. I think I've spotted a little gap through the trees. We might see her a bit clearer. Hang on a second. There we go. Look at that there, Brian. You should see it clearly through there now. Oh, look at that beautiful view. That side lighting, this is a photographer's dream. I think especially if you've got some bigger lenses. Might be able to get it nicely through here. Still hear some other alarm calls in the distance. Just going to see where this female does move to from here. Going to sit here and spend some time with her. Cross over to James and just see what he's up to. I think he's just got onto cheetah planes.
Right, everybody, we have indeed just got to Cheetah Plains, and we're sitting here at 3 in a row pan. Well, not sitting so much as doing a drive-by. There was some zebra that scuttled off into the woodland over there. Haven't found any tracks yet, but it is a glorious morning here. You have found Karula, which is brilliant, and there's a mistiness about it, which makes everything rather mysterious and very pleasant indeed. Let us stop briefly here and observe the water. There is a blacksmith lapwing. I'm just going to find out quickly exactly where that... Somebody's called in a lion, but I think it's on Chitwa Chitwa. Please confirm location of that sighting. My radio comms are not great here on Cheetah Plains. It's so quiet and so lovely out here. It feels like we're the only people here. And in the background you can hear a red-crested korhan. Doop, 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 doop. Hello, Kyle McSetters. You say, can we please go and look for Inkanyeni? Kyle McSetters, we are doing just that. It's not really a question of just sort of going to look for her. She almost has to kind of find us. We will hopefully find some tracks, maybe. And if we're very lucky, she'll be draped in a tree somewhere close by. But yes, Inkanyeni or Quarantine, two leopards we might see here. It would be great to meet Inkanyeni's youngsters. We haven't met them yet. Oh, I haven't. Have you met them, Vim?
No. Inkanyeni.
Yes. What is the youngsters? The babies.
No.
So, that would be great, Kyle. So let's carry on. We might also be lucky with some cheetah in the plains, especially early morning. They might still be hunting. Let's go and look. I'm interested that Karula seems to be hunting again, and that tells me that Dyker did not sufficiently satiate all three of their hungry mouths, and you could see how voraciously those little cubbies were eating yesterday. They were extremely hungry, were little George and Charlotte. All right, let's go back to Karula. Hopefully she will stay north of our boundary. We'll continue to the plains.
Well, James is checking Cheetah Plains. We are still here with Karula. She hasn't moved off that termite mound. It looks like she's just enjoying the sunlight there at the moment. Well, there's definitely something else in this area. We can hear alarm calls not far west of us. And it sounds like there's definitely impala alarm calling. And it sounds like a nyala or kudu, that is also alarm calling. They've got a very deep bark. Sometimes it's difficult to tell the difference if you don't listen carefully, but it's a bow, bow. It's a very loud bark that they give as an alarm call if they see a predator. So Lex has actually just gone into that area to go and have a look. We said we'll keep an eye on Karula. Again, the teamwork is very important out here, that you can try and see as much as possible while working with other people and working as a team, because it is not easy in the bush to do everything yourself. She is posing so beautifully for us. Shamsun has asked or said and made a comment that it's very interesting that he can't hear any birds alarm calling at the leopard. And don't birds alarm call at the leopards? They do occasionally, but often what happens is it is when they are moving around and if they are out in the open. And there's certain bird species that do alarm call at them. Rattling cisticulas, the grey go-away birds, starlings. A lot of those bird species will alarm call at them. Franklin, I've heard other birds of prey actually also alarm call at predators. But where she is at the moment, she's in a thicket and she's not really moving around too much. So you're not going to get a lot of bird activity around her or picking up on her moving through there. But if grey go-away birds, for example, did see her, they would alarm call. Often what the leopards do is they then walk and they raise their tail. And they show the white tip of their tail. And the theory behind that is that they are saying, okay, I know I have been seen, I know I have been spotted, I'm not a threat, I'm purely passing by. So they try and make themselves more visible. And the reason for that is then to try and move through the area as quickly as possible so that they can get away from the alarm calls. They don't want to attract too much attention to themselves. But good question, and it is interesting. While she's sitting there, there aren't any birds alarm calling at her. But I think it's because she's moving through this drainage line. It's a little bit thicker. She's well hidden. We can see her quite nicely now, but she's not really out in the open or close to anything that potentially could feel threatened. So the birds for now are leaving her alone. And also, I don't see any of those birds in this area at the moment. Nice little stretch. Oh dear, we're going to have to watch very carefully now. We can hear more impala alarm calling, but now off to our south, which is interesting. I don't want to lose sight of Karula. Try and follow her for as long as possible. Just keep scanning that area. While I try and get another glimpse of Karula, try to see exactly where she's going. We'll work out what these alarm calls are. Cross over to James. He's on Cheetah Plains. Let's see what he has.
Righty. Hello, everybody. We're just slowly making our way down towards the plains, driving very slowly. We saw a huge flock of African hoopoes. Now, those of you who live in the United Kingdom or somewhere around Europe, you'll know what a hoopoe is. And it was very unusual because there were about 10 of them in the one flock, which I thought was quite strange. But otherwise, things have been fairly quiet down here. We found a duiker. I think that was about all. A couple of kudu on the way here. Ah, now, behold this sign of the drought. That is not a python in the road, everybody. It is a pipe. But the pipe has been dug up by elephants. And that is because the elephants can feel the water moving under the surface of the ground. So you really, if you're going to put a borehole pipe in, you've got to bury it very deep. Otherwise the elephants will eventually dig it out. And that's exactly what's happened there. And that's going to be something of a problem, because they're going to have to fix that pipe. Otherwise Cheetah Plains Pan will not be pumped. They're so very clever. The elephants. Ah, now Betty, you have asked a question about one of the greatest, Betty, one of the greatest kind of, I think, misconceptions. You've asked a question about whether or not, given drought conditions or adverse conditions, animals are able to hold back their fetuses, so prolonged gestation. So I'll tell you where this comes from. It comes from Impala. Impala, we all know, synchronize their births at the end of November. And what happens is that people will tell you that, well, they can hold back giving birth if they have to, if the conditions are not great, and they can hold back giving birth for at least something like 3 or 4 months until February, for example. Now, this is... Sorry, I'm just going to... I've got 74 radios going in my ear. This is not possible. It's simply impossible, because what would happen is that the fetus would have to stop growing. And for the fetus to stop growing, it would have to stop having nutrients given to it, because if the fetus were to continue growing, obviously it would not, it would become impossible for it to be born. So no, it's absolutely not possible. Oh goodness, there is a lot of stuff going on here. Becca, I'm going to ask for you to link away from me if you don't mind. I need to try and sort out what's going on here. We've just got to figure out, there's thousands of vehicles here, everybody. Let's go back to Byron. I need to just figure out what's happening here.
So, welcome back, everyone. We lost a view of Karula. She moved off the termite mound. I'm trying to get around this big drainage line to see if we can't get back into that area on the other side. It's not easy. It's very thick, and I looked for an area to cross. But no luck yet. But I've just crossed through the drainage line on the road, but I'm going to try and get all the way back around to that area where she was. It's all very exciting. I'm so glad we did get to see her and the cubs, though. Oh dear, very, very thick here at the moment. There's no chance of us getting through here. Hope you're all enjoying this as much as I am. It's so great to be able to see a leopard and follow her and try to work out where she's going. It just shows you how difficult it is to find them. I mean, walking through those thick drainage lines, it's almost impossible to spot them. You really, really have to be very, very careful and look very closely. Okay. Trying to see the trees. Looking for the into the trees. I'll tell you why, is because while we drive around like that, it helps. There's a little daker I just spotted moving off. While we're driving around like that, if you can see a prominent tree, it makes it easier to then know which direction she was heading. You can use that as a reference point to try and work out exactly where these animals are going. Gremlins General has asked us, I think I'm in this area now where she was. Gremlins General has asked, do the leopards see color vision? So the theory and the understanding is no, they don't. They've got a neutral vision, so more black and white vision. That is the understanding. Look, while I try and maneuver through this area and work out where that leopard's gone, James has got an elephant to show you.
This is an enormous tuskless elephant bull, everybody. He's very close by. He's in full must. This is unbelievable. Look at him. He's a huge, huge elephant bull. Isn't that awesome? Isn't that fantastic? And he didn't even look at us. Now, he's got no tusks. Now, that is very unusual. Now, it's all happening here, Cheetah Plains. There's some lions just down the road here. So I think we'll probably try and move in there once we've had a look at that magnificent elephant. He's fully grown. Just hang on a sec. Go ahead. I was trying to stand by for the cheetah position, but it seemed like there were three or four people already standing by. If there's space there, I'd like to come there. Sorry, there's cheetah, there are lions, everything all over the place here. But the radio is an absolute disaster, so it's very difficult to hear what's going on. Thanks, that would be great, Mike. Sorry, everybody, I am just trying to find out what's going on here. Mike, I'm in no rush, I'll just gently make my way there. Alright, we're just going to go and have a quick look. Okay, we're going to go and quickly have a look at the cheetah, everybody. They seem to be on the far southeastern corner, so we'll just nip down there, and that we might get a quick view of them. Hold on tight. I'm sorry about my lack of attention to your needs, but the radio is just very difficult to understand what's happening here. There's lots of action, which means everybody is very excited about what's going on here. There's some vultures. Now, there were some three male lions killed. In fact, we'll go back there just now. Three male lions killed here yesterday. We don't know who those male lions are. Three females as well from a seemingly unknown pride came into the area as well. So it's all very exciting. Now, we'll just try and get around the corner here. I'm not exactly sure where those cheetah are. So if I do have to ignore you, I'll just be finding out on the radio what's going on. Now, we did have a question there, Rebecca, from James. I'm afraid I missed it. You wouldn't mind giving it to me again? James, you were worried about elephants attacking a vehicle, and you say, what do you do if an elephant attacks? James, what we do if an elephant attacks is you try and make sure you're not in the way. So, for example, you read the elephant's behavior, and I could see that elephant paid us almost no heed at all. He would not have just attacked. He would have warned us, almost certainly. And elephants are very good at warning you, which means that if they get upset, you can tell. If you then stay in their way, well, then you're asking for trouble. The key thing is, if you're with elephants and you think that they're a little bit uneasy, what you have to do is just make sure you've got a forward escape route and you've got to read their behavior. And the key thing is increasing space. It's no good saying, I'm going to stand down this elephant, I'm going to teach it a lesson, I'm going to be the big deal, and I'm not going to run away from it. That's a really bad idea. Okay, we're going to try and get into this cheetah sighting. Let's head back to Byron and Karula. It's all action at the moment. Go ahead.
Yes, that's right, James. It is all action at the moment. We found her again. We drove quite a way around. Luckily, we recognized the trees in the area. And we thought, let's have a look here. And she's curled up on top of a termite mound, quite well hidden, but she's warming up in the sun. I don't see any sign of the cubs at the moment. She may have left them somewhere. They could be hiding it's very thick around here. They could be hiding, but she may have left them in a drainage line while she is making her way around, potentially looking for food. But now she's resting beautifully on this termite mound. So exciting. St. James has got cheetah on cheetah plains, and lions about. It's all happening. Beautiful, beautiful face. You know, James is rushing to try and find some cheetah for you. As soon as I get any word that he has got them, we'll cross over to him, just so you can hopefully get a view of those cheetah too. And then we can definitely see, you'll be able to see the difference between the cheetah and the leopard, how different they look. It's always nice to see a live animal to tell the difference between the two. Trump's buffoon has asked us, how do the cubs stay so well hidden? Does she communicate with them and tell them to stay in a specific area? Yes, she definitely does. It's amazing. The communication between leopards or any adult and the young is incredible. Lionesses do the same if they are at a den site, and they will give a contact call or a certain call to tell the cubs to stay, and they stay in that area. They do not move. Same with these leopard. So leopard will move around, once they give birth, they'll have a den site, and those cubs know to stay at their den site until the female returns. Those beautiful paws. She's got her paws tucked in, trying to keep them warm. And the leopards will give a call, a contact call. And I also think, we don't really understand the communication that well. But I've seen it where they're walking with their cubs and she gives a certain call and she walks into an area, and then as she walks out, the cubs don't follow anymore. They stay right there. So they know. Look at those beautiful rosettes that I spoke about. Beautiful markings and the pattern on the leopard. So the cubs know to stay in that area. They will not move until that female returns. This is so special. This is amazing. Go ahead, Lex. Okay, copy. Lex, we're still with Karula. She's come down a little bit, but still in that same area that you left her in, around that termite mound. She's just lying down at the moment. No sign of the youngsters. So Lex was just telling me that he found where the kudu and the impala were alarm calling, but he can't see anything around there. Potentially another leopard that was moving through the area. But it's not always that easy. They'll alarm call those antelope soon. Sorry, I'm just getting an update from Lex. Okay, copy, Lex. Thank you. So as I was saying, so Lex was just telling me where those alarm calls were coming from exactly. But as I was saying, when these animals do get alarm called at, they'll try and move out of the area because they know, and especially with leopard, if antelope like impala or kudu start alarm calling, it draws a lot of attention to them. And they don't like that attention. They don't like potentially hyenas trying to follow them, because hyenas will be alerted. They'll come and have a look, see if there's a potential kill they can steal. So they generally try and move out of that area very, very quickly if they are being alarm called at. It sounds like James has just found the cheetah. Cross over and see what they are up to.
Well, everybody, look at that beautiful, beautiful, beautiful sighting. Two male cheetah, our male friends. Unfortunately, they seem to be about to head off into Mala Mala, which is a bit sad, but we're just going to have a quick view of them. What a joy to have these cats, Karula and her cubs, over the last little while. We have truly been blessed beyond it. We are so lucky. Just move along here. I'm pretty sure the other one will get up and come across as well. Now, we can only be on the boundary. This is the kind of end of when we're going to be able to see them. Isn't that wonderful? Unfortunately, that's going into Mala Mala, but that's okay. They look very fat. They look like they've had an exceptionally good meal. Stunning stuff. Fantastic. So they are, for those of you who don't know, everybody, we're not going to be able to see them again once they've got into Mala Mala. James Richard, you say, considering cheetah have such an incredibly low genetic diversity, you say, are they likely to be more susceptible to diseases? Definitely. Absolutely. To some extent. But at the same time, although they are probably susceptible to more diseases, everyone, they are pretty resilient. And, you know, the big legend you'll hear is that cheetah are all descended from one female. You know, their genetic diversity is so low that they're probably all descended from one female. Now, I'm not convinced that that's true. I don't know. I mean, they can pretty accurately tell, I suppose, from sort of genetic studies. But whether that's, you know, how susceptible to disease that makes them, or if it's actually true or not, I don't know. But I think it's become one of these things that is quoted by guides all over the world now, simply because, you know, I'm not sure how thoroughly it's been investigated. But they do have a lower genetic diversity, and apparently you can do a skin graft from any cheetah anywhere in the world and it will take, and that's because the genetics of them are pretty low. The pool is shallow. Very nice. They're just marking territory. And the territory, of course, of a cheetah is temporary. It's not it doesn't stick in an area like a leopard or a lion territory, because their distribution is almost solely based on their ability to avoid other predators. We are very, very lucky, everyone. Cubs, leopard, and magnificent cheetah. This is a rare treat. And for those of you who are perhaps new viewers, you know we don't see cheetah very often at all. It's not common for us to view them like this. And simply because there are not that many around, the habitat is not ideal for them. Oh, I got a picture there, if you can believe it, Liam, but I did miss his feet, unfortunately. He was sort of in focus. It's almost in focus. Everybody, I am the world's slowest and possibly most useless photographer. Yeah, no, it's a disaster. I'll show you the picture a bit later. Liam, of course, will derive enormous amusement from it. And I think one of them, although they're probably brothers, and although you'll be told that there isn't a great deal of kind of dominance between the two, it would seem to me that the one of them always follows the other. So this chap, you can see, is basically doing what his brother's doing. He's marking on the same trees and marking in the same places, but well behind. Let's just see if we can't get a last view of them. They're just lying on the boundary there. Wimpy, let me try and get a bit of height so we can see on top of them. I fear me the super zoom camera would have been a better option here. Perfect light. Oh, gorgeous morning. I think this is going to be a two. Well, we've still got them there, everyone. Beautiful. I'm afraid that's going to be the best view we have of them. They'll probably lurk there for a little while. It's still quite cool, so I suspect they'll move. I'm 95% sure they won't be doing any hunting, simply because they are very full already. You could see their bellies swollen and hanging. So I don't think there's going to be much in the way of hunting today. Now, Richard, you want to know the territory of a lion and a cheetah overlaps. They do overlap, Richard, and they must overlap. And they overlap for a very good reason, and that is that they eat different things. They occupy a different niche. And although there is overlap in what they eat, they occupy a different niche. And so there is overlap, but cheetah will avoid lions at all costs. Their distribution is often, and quite interestingly, is normally dictated by the distribution of male lions. Now, only about a quarter of a mile from here, there are three male lions feeding on a buffalo carcass. So in this particular case, it doesn't seem to have made a huge difference. There's a very amusing vehicle next to us. And Velma, you're wondering about how they're going to mate. Are they going to find females? Will they leave their territory to go and find females? Yes, I suppose they might. But I think you'll find more it's a case of females actually seeking them out. So often that happens with the cats, where the female will seek out the male, and she will lie down, or, you know, she will come and mark in an area. And what happens is that there is a female that moves through this area. She'll mark her territory here, and if she's coming into estrus, that will leave a certain amount of pheromone in the urine. They'll pick that up, and they will then try and find her. Beautiful afternoon, at least morning. I think they'll probably get up again and move off to the south. And we'll try and go to those lions as well at some stage. I think there was such a mad rush for the lions and for the cheetah that people who were in the lion sighting came screaming out to have a look at these chaps. Now they've gone back to the lions. So I think we'll just stand by and enjoy this. And then perhaps we'll go to the lions. Not sure what Karula's story is at the moment, There, you can see they're getting up and moving now. It's completely opposite to what I said initially. I initially said that I thought that male that has been left behind here was the one who was leading the charge, and I don't think that is the case anymore. You can see they look almost identical, and we don't spend enough time around them to really be able to see the difference. Anyway, everybody, I think that's going to be it. A Twitter handle from someone called Trump's Buffoon here. I'm going to hope deeply that's a facetious Twitter handle. You say, do cheetah kill cubs in the same way that lions do? Do they engage in infanticide? Trump's Buffoon, they do. Probably not as much, but unrelated male mammals of just about any species will kill unrelated youngsters. It's one of the driving forces, actually, of mammal evolution and mammal social structure evolution. It's quite an interesting thing. Lions, obviously, the most obvious example. These guys, of course, if they do father youngsters, are highly unlikely that their cubs will come across an unrelated male. But an unrelated male could well kill them. The leading cause of leopard cub death, unrelated male leopards. A huge part of cheetah social structure is... A huge part of chimpanzee social structure, for example, is infanticide, and certainly one of the big drivers in their sociology. Now, a wonderful, warm, low-felt welcome to a Rodine School for Young Girls. All of you in Grade 1, Madam Creel and Madam McConnell. Hello, Madam McConnell and Madam Creel. I hope you're all having a lovely, chilly Joburg morning. I hope it's not too cold for you there. It's pretty chilly here, but it's not nearly as cold as it is there for you. We've just had two cheetah there. Unfortunately, they've crossed south of our boundary, so let's just look at those cheetah quickly. My name is James, and on the camera today is Viam, and also going to be taking you around a little bit for the next hour or so is Byron, and Byron's a very good friend of mine. And you know what? Byron and I both went to school not too far from where you went to school. I was just across the road, and Byron a little bit further up the ridge. So we know that area where you are very well. See the cheetah? Beautiful, beautiful special cats. We're so lucky to see them, and I don't think they look very big from where you're sitting, but they're very tall, you know. They'll probably stand at the shoulders, that's the top of their backs, about as tall as your shoulders, and that's a pretty big animal. It probably weighs as much as a full-grown man. So big cats. And of course the cheetah, as everybody knows, or if you don't, you will now, is the fastest land mammal in the world. You know how fast they can run? They can run at 100 kilometers per hour. That's the same speed as you and your dad drive along the highway. That's an amazing speed, but they can't run for very, very far. So if you have any questions at all, if you want to ask me or Byron anything about the things that we're seeing, please feel free to ask us questions. We'd love to hear from you. Now, my friend Byron from One Cheetah, now you can ask him the difference between a cheetah and a leopard. He's got a beautiful female leopard to show you.
Yes, James, everything's going on at the moment. We're still with this beautiful female leopard. I think this is going to be our last glimpse of her. She's moving off through the thicket, but we have spent quite a bit of time with her. It was lovely to see the cubs this morning. Good morning to Rodine and Madam O'Connell and Madam Creel and their class of grade ones. Lovely to have you with us this morning. So glad you joined us just in time to get a glimpse of this leopard. Now the birds are alarm calling at her, rattling cesticulas, and she's raised her tail so that she can show them that she's not a threat. She's trying to just move through the area. I think that is the last glimpse we're going to see of that leopard. So for the new Rodine girls, my name is Byron, and we have Brian on camera with me this morning. It's great to have you with us. And the thumb. So I was speaking about the alarm calling. Now that is a distress call or an alarm call that animals give to warn each other that there's a predator in that area. So in this occasion, the birds are alarm calling to warn potentially each other or other animals that there's a predator moving through here. Now, even though those birds are in no danger from the leopard, they still alarm call because it is pure instinct. They want to warn everyone that there's a predator around. This morning early, we got to see Karula, this female leopard, with her two little cubs. We saw them quite briefly. She was moving them. Yesterday, they had a kill. She was feeding on a daca, and they got to eat. All of them got to eat, which was great. But during the course of the evening, she lost the kill. I think what may have happened is while she was feeding, or while one of the cubs was feeding, they knocked it out of the tree, and I think hyena came and stole it. So this morning, she was moving them into a safer area, away from the area where all the hyena activity is. And what she did then was, it looks like she's hidden them in this beautiful, there's a little drainage line you can't see, but just behind us and further back where was the last time we saw them. I think she's hidden the cubs in there, and she's heading off now potentially to go and try and hunt again to provide food for those little cubs. Really glad you got to see her though. So it's all been happening this morning. We've had cheetah, we've had leopard with cubs. It's been a fantastic, fantastic morning. We're going to move out of this area now, see what else we can find. Look where we're going. There's been a lot of alarm calling in this area from other animals too. We just heard impala, and they give a very distinct alarm call. It's a sound, it sounds like a snort, like a pfft. Oh, my alarm calling is terrible. Brian's laughing at me. It's like a nasal snort, and it's a very strange sound. But what they do is if they see a predator, they will alarm call and make a noise to warn each other and say there's danger around, you must be careful. And then they hopefully will move away without the predator, or the leopard in this case, hunting them. But also, we want the leopards to eat. So it's a give and take situation. So Jamie has asked us, how many animals do we see every day? So Jamie, it all depends. It depends on how lucky we are with driving through the bush, because sometimes you can drive through the bush and go on a game drive and see very, very little animal movement, but you enjoy the other little things that you might see, or just enjoy the sounds and the smells in the bush. Some days we see a lot, like yesterday, James and I saw a lot on game drive. We saw wild dog, we saw leopard, we saw lions, we saw elephant, we saw buffalo. So there was a lot going on yesterday. This morning we've been very lucky too. We've seen leopard, we've seen impala, we've seen elephant, James has seen the cheetah. So there's a lot that we do see while we're out on our safaris or on our game drives. But it all depends. It all depends. You can never predict what you're going to see. But Jamie, sometimes we see lots of animals and sometimes we don't see too much. But that's what makes it so exciting, is we don't know what we are going to see. Oh dear, it sounds like James is having a lot of luck this morning. So I'm going to carry on checking around this area, maybe see if that leopard doesn't come out again. But James has got something else, another predator that he wants to show you.
Well, look at that, everybody. We've got a whole lot of lions. three female lions and their big male lion. And in the background, you can probably hear some elephants shouting. And I'm whispering because when you're in the wilderness like this, you want to be very quiet so you can hear what's going on around you. So these three lions have killed a buffalo. So it wasn't a very good day yesterday for that buffalo, unfortunately. But the lions have to eat, and we know that they're the greatest carnivores in Africa, and they have to eat meat. So that's what they're doing. And then the male lion, he's the one with the lots of hair on him. He isn't eating at the moment because he's so full and fat that he can't think about eating any more meat. And if you look carefully, you can see the female is also very fat. See that big fat belly? She's so full because she's been eating so much meat. Now that buffalo probably weighed about 400 kilograms. Now most of you probably don't weigh more than 25 kilograms. So that is more than 20 times your size. So they are very big animals. And the lions are very big as well. Those lions are about twice the size of those two cheetah we just saw. Huge. So I know many of you have been to the Kruger Park and many of you have seen lions like this. But they really are very, very big. Look. Look at the eyes looking at us. Now, a very interesting question from Khalela. Khalela, you want to know when the cheetahs are going to eat their prey. I don't think they're going to eat today, Khalela. You can see they were very fat and they probably hunted yesterday. They hunt during the daytime. The lions, of course, we know hunt during the nighttime, and they killed this buffalo not yesterday but the day before that. So the cheetah probably won't be eating today. Now we've got something else we can show you. But let's just watch these, see what they do. You see how well camouflaged they are? We discussed yesterday the concept of camouflage with the great noughts. And camouflage is the color that the lions are that makes them very difficult to see. Now, where are they going? I don't know where they're going. They might want some water, but water is, I know, the other way. Maybe they're just full and they've had enough to eat. Who knows? Let's watch the male, see what he does. And Lily, you ask a very good question. You say, will the lions eat the buffalo's head? Yes, they will. They'll eat most of it. You can see them, the front of the buffalo's head. Now, I know this is a bit disgusting for some of you, everybody, but don't worry about it. That buffalo, of course, doesn't feel anything anymore. It is long gone. There's a soft bit around the nose there that the lions will eat. They will probably eat most of the neck, and so they'll eat the nose, but I don't think that they're going to eat the rest of the skull. The skull, remember, is the head bone, and the head bone's very hard, and only maybe a hyena will be strong enough to get into the head bone and bite it. Look how big he is. He's a massive animal. He's marking his territory now. That's how animals mark their territory. They rub their heads, and now he'll spray. He had a little bit of a spray of urine. Let's go backwards and see if we can spot the others. They've just gone to sleep there. Eva, hello to you. You want to know how long the lions will stay with the buffalo. They'll eat the buffalo until it's finished, you know, Eva. And sometimes it can smell so disgusting that you couldn't believe that any animal would want to eat a buffalo that smelt so very disgusting. But lions don't care, you know. They really don't care at all what it smells like. They're very happy to eat the most smelly thing in the world. Something that you and I wouldn't even look at, let alone think about eating, these lions will eat. Let's just ease up here. Just watch where the lion's going. There's a female's coming past the front of the car. Hello, Pierre. You want to know why dad lions have got lots of fur around their heads? Well, it's like a beard. You know that your dad's got a beard. He probably shaves his beard off, but if he didn't shave it, then he would have a very long beard, and you know that your mother doesn't have a beard. And it's the same thing with lions and lionesses. Lionesses don't have a big beard. The males do have a big beard. But that big beard of the male lions, everybody, is probably there to protect his neck, because male lions like to fight. They fight often. And that beard, that huge mane, it's called a mane, huge mane helps them to avoid being hurting themselves when they're fighting. I think we should follow him. Let's leave the lionesses to their smelly breakfast, and let's follow the male lion down through the bushes there and see where he goes. Oops, hit a bush there. I think the female is not too far from here. That other female walked off in here somewhere. And maybe he's going to look for her. Maybe he's going to find another male lion. Let's find out. Everything out here is a big mystery, and it's often very difficult to understand what's happening. There he is. And Tegan, you ask a very, very good question. You say, why do lions mark their territory? Tegan, lions mark their territory because they don't want to have other lions come into their territory. It's the same way that when you are at home, you lock your door. You know that not everybody is allowed to just walk into your house, right? And it's the same thing with the territory here. That's spraying urine there, everybody. He's having a wee on that branch. And while that's a bit disgusting as well, that's how he marks his territory. So, Tegan, it's impossible. You know people are not allowed just into your house. And the same thing the lions are doing here. They're saying, this is my house. I've been here for the longest. So everybody else stay out. And of course, there are no doors here. You can't have a fence or anything like that. So he marks his boundary with his urine. There's the female. Oh, no, they're very tired. Lions get very, very tired, everyone, because they eat so very much. Let me just go around the other side there. I think we might get a nice view of him. Are you happy here, Ben? Probably actually better here. We just try and get a little bit closer to him. And Lyra, you ask a very good question. You say, why don't they attack us? Why don't these huge, fearsome animals attack us when we're so close to them? Why don't they jump on the back of the car and eat us? And, well, Lyra, you know what? They're just used to us. And it's because we're around here quite a lot that they just don't see us as something to eat. And that's why they don't eat us. If we came here on foot, remember we're in a car now, if we came here on foot, they would be much more likely to have a bite of us. But they'd also be more likely to run away. You see how tired he is? He's so very tired. I don't know where the other male is. Apparently there were two males here, but only one male that we can see. And you can see, I bet many of you have got cats at home, and you know that your cats at home do more of sleeping than they do anything else. And it's the same with lions. I'm sure many of you know that there are 24 hours in one day. Do you know how many of those hours lions can sleep for? They can sleep for 20 hours of the day. That's a very, very long time. Hello, Abigail. You're wondering about baby lion cubs and how small they are. Well, when they're born, Abigail, they're probably about the size of half a ruler. So you've got a ruler there that's 30 centimeters long. So a baby lion cub, when it's born, is probably about 15 centimeters, which is very, very small. But then by the time they reach 6 months old, they're probably bigger than, I don't know if you guys know what a Labrador is. It's a kind of a dog, like a big dog, probably about the size of a Labrador or an Alsatian dog. That's only after 6 months. And by the time they're a year old, they're bigger than any dog you've ever met. And by the time they're 2 years old, well, and they're just enormous. They're the biggest cats that we get out here. So they grow very quickly. See the vulture? Look at the vulture! That's very special. Those are called hooded vultures, everybody, and they're waiting for the lions to leave that buffalo alone so that they can go and eat the last little bits of meat. They have to be very, very patient or they don't eat at all. And Ava, you want to know about how many cubs the lions have. Ava, it's normally 3 or 4, but sometimes it can be as many as 6. But normally, if they have 6 cubs, well, it's very unlikely that they will all survive. See how they're just going to sleep now? This is what lions do. They like to have a snooze for a long time, especially when their bellies are that full. Amy, that's a very astute question from you. Let's move with them. Amy, you say, how many bird species have I seen this morning? Amy, I don't know. I don't think I've counted, but I can go through them quickly while we move the car. We've seen hornbills and starlings, and we've seen hoopoes, and we've seen babblers, and what else have we seen? We've seen 2 or 3 species of vulture. We've seen, what else? Franklins. We've seen doves. So probably about 15 species of birds so far this morning. But there are, you know how many birds there are found here? There are over 250 birds found in this area. See, now he's so tired, he's so lazy, but he doesn't want his friend to leave. He doesn't want his girlfriend to leave, but he's too lazy to get up and follow her. So now he doesn't really know what to do. He's a very good looking fellow, isn't he? He's a lovely looking lion. Kira, you say Byron made an impala sound, but you didn't hear it. And you want to know what an impala sounds like. An impala, when it's very, very scared, goes. Bit like that. Viam's looking at me as though I'm mad, but it sounds a little bit like that, Kira. It's a big snort. Isn't he a lovely fellow? He's a very special lion. We're very lucky to spend some time with him. And Fatima, you're wondering about why lions eat so much. Well, they eat so much because they're so big. You know that your dad and your mum eat much more than you do, and that's because they're much bigger than you are. And this little chap, this chap, is more than twice the weight of your father, and so he eats much more than twice the weight that your father eats. Remember also, Fatima, they don't eat every day. Now watch him. See that? That's very special. What he's doing there is testing the air. I know it looks like he's cross, like he's growling, but he isn't. He's testing the urine that the female put there, and he's testing to see whether she wants to become a mummy lion again or not. So this is a very special thing we're seeing. See that? See how it looks like he's half smiling and half growling? And I think he's going to follow this female. Let's go and see. There she is. Oh, he's such a fat-bellied fellow. He's had so much buffalo meat to eat, he doesn't know what to do with himself. We're so lucky to have this very special sighting while you guys are with us. You know, we don't always see cheetah and lion and leopard in one drive. That's very unusual. Hello, Pia. You want to know why birds called babblers are called babblers? Well, Pia, because they babble. They make a big noise. It sounds like they're having a conversation the whole time. They go... See, the lion doesn't like my call, so I'm not going to do it again. Lioness is looking at me as though I'm mad. And Jamie, you went to Monte Cassino Bird Park yesterday and you say you saw lots of birds of prey. Well, that's great. Did you see any vultures? We've got two wonderful vultures looking at us now. I wonder if you saw those vultures at the Bird of Prey Center at Monte Cassino. Those vultures, if I'm not mistaken, are called hooded vultures. We get five different kinds of vultures here, and that particular one is known as the hooded vulture. Here comes the lioness. She's moving again. Turning around and going to sleep. Ugh. So tired. I'm just going to help somebody else get into the sighting, everybody. Ooh, look at the vultures coming in here. They're all eating something on the ground here. This is amazing. Let me move the car. I'm going to move it very slowly because the vultures might run away. I think, you know what I think they're eating? I think that they're eating lion dung. I don't think there's any meat there. Yeah, they're flying off because they're just a little bit scared of the car. Huge, huge birds. So I think that they're eating lion dung. Let me just move back and see if we can't get a decent picture. Yeah, you see, we can't get any closer than this, so I'm not going to try. Let's go back to the lions. And we can have a look at this big hooded vulture over here. There we go. Now that bird, everybody, you've all seen a hardy-dar, I'm sure, in your garden. You know what a hardy-dar is? That bird's about twice the size of a hardy-dar. Huge, huge bird. And he's got a very special beak. You see, his beak is very thin and it's very sharp. And that very thin, sharp beak allows him to eat the bits and pieces of meat on a buffalo carcass that no other animal can get to. Emma, you are very clever because you've just noticed something. And you've noticed something about the vultures and the way they fly. And you say it seems to you that vultures are too big to fly and that it probably makes it a little bit difficult for them to fly being so big. Emma, they can fly very well, but what you've noticed is that they don't fly so well when they're close to the ground. It's difficult for them to take off in the same way that, you know, an aeroplane has to have a runway, it has to get some speed before it can take off. Well, vultures have a similar sort of a problem because they're so heavy. But once they're up and once they're flying in the hot air, once there's hot air rising off the ground, they're brilliant flyers and they can fly for hours and hours and hours without having to come down at all. So yes, not very good at flying like a sparrow. You've seen sparrows and starlings flying about the place, like the birds that you have in your garden. Very good at flying from branch to branch and around and quick. These chaps not so good at that, but once they get up in the air, they're really very good flyers indeed. Let's have a look at the lions again. And you can see this lioness, the female, well, there are two things you must notice about her. The first is that she's very, very tired. She's breathing very heavily. And the second is that her face is dirty. You see that? And her face is dirty because she's been eating buffalo. So she's got blood on her bed, on her front. Lily, interesting one from you. You want to know why lions and other cats, like your house cats, have got whiskers. Lily, we're not entirely sure, you know, but we think it's to help them feel what's going on around them. Remember, they are active mostly in the night time, and we think maybe that their whiskers help them to feel around the place when they're moving at night. I'm not sure about that, though, so I'm going to say to you, Lily, that I don't really know why they have whiskers. And I know that might be a bit strange, but you know, we just don't know everything. Especially me. So we don't really know why they have whiskers. Look at the big teeth there. Huge teeth. And the next time you go home, and I don't know how many of you have cats and dogs at home, but if you look in your cat or your dog's mouth, you'll find the same arrangement of teeth. These ones are just much, much bigger. But very similar kind of teeth to the ones that you have. And Khalela Sang, you want to know how much a lion eats every day. Well, it depends, you know, it depends very much on what the lion eats. So if they kill a buffalo, like they've just killed this buffalo, they probably won't eat for the next 4 days. Now, can you imagine having a supper so very big that you didn't need to eat for the next 4 days? Well, that's what these buffalo have done. At least that's what these lions have done. So they're not like us, where you have 3 meals a day and a snack for break and something like that. They only eat probably every 4 days or so. And that depends on what they kill. So these guys have killed a buffalo. If, however, they had killed something small, say, let's pretend that they'd killed an impala, which is a small antelope. Well, what you'll find then is that they will have to eat again very soon, because an impala isn't a very good meal for a lion. Now, I'm going to show you something quite special, everybody. Viam, if I can ask you to come back towards the tree where the vulture was. We've got two kinds of vultures. Well, we've got five, but this one is a different one. This one is a very, very rare vulture, everybody. And I know it looks probably the same to you, but it isn't. It's a special vulture called a white-headed vulture. And it doesn't have a white head yet because it's still a young one. But you can see it's got a very red beak at the end of its beak. And it is a juvenile white-headed vulture. Now, it's a huge bird. It's very uncommon. And it's probably almost endangered. And you know how tall it is? If you pick up your ruler, if you've got one close by, that is almost 3 rulers tall. So if you put 3 rulers on top of each other, that's how big that huge bird is. Look at him flying. Wonderful to see. Just beautiful. So let's just have a quick look here. I'll just show you the two kinds of birds. So there's the white-backed vulture, and there is the hooded vulture. See that? And this one is much smaller. That's about 2 rulers tall. This chap is about 3 rulers tall. Huge, big, white-headed vulture. Beautiful. And Eva, you want to know if vultures ever kill things for themselves. There are 2 or 3 species that can, but don't very often. So the white-backed vulture, which is the most common vulture we get here, they sometimes kill for themselves. And also the leopard-faced vulture, which is a very, very big vulture, probably, say, 2.5 rulers tall. They sometimes kill on their own. Right, I think we should go back towards that carcass where the buffalo is and see if the other lionesses are still eating there. What do you think? Because these chaps, I think, are just going to go to sleep now. And it's starting to get hot. Starting to get very hot indeed. So I'm just going to put on my sun hat. There we go. You'll hear a little bit of ruffling around at the sound. Sorry about that. But the sun hat is very necessary. You know that you have to wear a sun hat out here in the wild. Because if you don't, well, you get very burnt skin. All right, let's go back towards the other lions. We'll see also if we can spot some more vultures. We've had the white-backed vultures. I've definitely seen some here. Oh, and I know a lot of you are excited by birds. There's a bird called a purple roller. Isn't that nice? He was... Okay. Let's see if we can go and see what the others are doing. She's so tired and so full that she can't really sleep. So she wants to sleep, but it's very difficult for her to sleep because her tummy is so full. Now, I don't know if any of you have ever eaten so much that you can hardly sleep. But if you think of the hugest meal you've ever had, imagine that times two. And that's what the lion's eaten, and that's how she feels. She's so tired, but she's so full that she really doesn't even know how to sleep. It's probably how some of you feel after you've been to a birthday party. That's how she feels. All right, let's quickly move along and see if we can find the other kill. My friend Byron's got another bird to show you.
So James has had so much luck with that lion kill and the vultures, and he just showed you a purple roller. This is a lilac-breasted roller. Beautiful, beautiful bird. So many different colors. They say there's about seven different colors on that bird. Seven or eight different colors. So we can see, what can we see? I think, why don't you, all the girls at Rodine, try and count there quickly and tell me how many colors you can see. Let me know, tell your teachers to send in the answers and we'll see how close you get. So our bird life this morning is really great. And Amy was the one who wanted to see a lot of birds. There's been so much going on with all the big animals, the elephant and the lions feeding on a buffalo. Very exciting. Looks like this roller's got something stuck on his beak. Possibly just a little bit of sand or mud. Very, very beautiful bird. And when they fly, when they open their wings, they've got a bright, bright, bright blue color under their wings. One of my favorite birds to see. And how they get the name roller is when they fly in the sky, they sometimes have, or they do this wonderful call. It's a very loud, harsh screeching sound, and while they do that, they then stop flapping their wings and they do loops in the air, like these little half moon loops, and they roll a little bit, and then as they come down they twist from side to side. It looks very funny, and they shake their wings from side to side and they come all the way down and land in a tree. And that is how they get the name roller, is because of that wonderful display they do in the sky. It's starting to warm up nicely. The sun is baking down on Brian and I, and we're becoming more and more relaxed out here. It was a bit cooler this morning, a bit cold. I hope all of you are warm in your classrooms. Up to 10 different colors. I'm assuming that would be just a few different shades of perhaps blue and brown and that purple or lilac color, that pinkish purple color. Very, very beautiful color. So glad he has sat there for a while. Allowed us to watch him and view him. We're going to continue searching for some other animals. While I do that, James has still got those lions with the buffalo kill. Let's see what they are up to.
Now Now, everybody, this is going to be a little bit disgusting, so you might want to hide your faces. We won't be here for very long. I just want to show you the two lionesses. Even though they are as fat as that other lioness that we were looking at, they are still eating. So it's like you, like I was saying to you, it's like you going to one birthday party, and then you have to go to another one, and then another one straight after that. Can you imagine how full you would be? And that's what these lions are doing. They're having a good steak meal. Now, lions are what we call carnivores. The leopard you saw is also a carnivore. The cheetah you saw is also a carnivore. And a carnivore means that they eat meat only. So they'll only eat meat. And so although it's not so nice sometimes to see an animal get killed, well, it's a little bit like us. You know how we eat chicken, and we eat beef, and we eat pork? Well, it's the same thing. We also have to kill animals to eat, and it's the same thing as these lions. And Izzy, you say, why do lions have such big teeth? Well, if you want to kill a buffalo for your supper, Izzy, you've got to have a weapon. And the big weapon that lions have are those big teeth, and of course those big claws that they've got. They've got very sharp claws, and they have to have, otherwise it would be impossible for them to kill animals like this buffalo, and that would be impossible for them to eat then. Even if they wanted to, they couldn't eat vegetables. Now, Lily, I think it's a very clever question you've asked. You say, do lions eat grass at all? They do sometimes. I don't know how many of you have got dogs at home, but I'm sure some of you do, and some of you would have seen them eating long green grass sometimes. You must think to yourself that it's very strange that they do that. I'm just going to quickly talk to Andrew on the radio, then I'll get back to you, Lily. Yeah, sure, go for it, Andrew. We've got two females here and one male, and then the other male and female have moved off towards the south. So Lily, they can eat grass in the same way that dogs sometimes eat grass. And what that does is it helps them to line the digestive tract. Now I know that's quite a complicated way of saying things, but I'll say it again for you. Line the digestive tract. And what it does, it just means that it helps that meat that they eat, all that meat, to get through their tummies and out the other side and get digested properly. So sometimes they have to eat a little bit of grass just to help that process, in the same way that your dogs at home sometimes do that. And Gail, you say you've lost your appetite. Well, that's good, Gail. It's not necessarily good, but I tell you why this is important for us. Because you know what, people? When we go to shops as human beings, and we buy meat in a packet, we often don't think about really where it comes from. Well, this is where it comes from. This is the kind of thing that we're eating, and it's just packed up nicely in a package. And it's a good idea sometimes just to give consideration to the animals that we do eat as human beings. I eat meat. You, I'm sure most of you eat meat. And it's a good idea just to give consideration to where those things come from. Right, I think I've had enough of seeing the stinky lions and the stinky food they're eating. But who of you would like to see an elephant? Look over there. Jamie, you want to know how big mummy lions are compared with daddy lions? A daddy lion is about 200 kilograms, Jamie. Oh, look at that bust. Wonderful vulture flying away there. And a mummy lion is about 120 kilograms. Now that is about, I'm just going to try and work it out the same as you. If you're about 20 kilograms or 25 kilograms, a mummy lion is then about 5 times more than you, and a daddy lion about 10 times more than you. I'm just waving at Andrew. Enjoy. The other two went through there, Andrew. Okay. Oh, look, these elephants, I think, are very thirsty. They're going to come and have a drink here. Lots of them coming out of the bush here. This is brilliant. And Mia, you want to know how animals camouflage themselves. Mia, they don't camouflage themselves. They are camouflaged by the color that they are. So if you look at an elephant is actually very good color out here. If it walks through the bushes, it's very difficult to see, being the color that it is. And then you get things like lions, which are the same color as the grass in the winter, tawny and gold and brown. And then you get leopards, like Karula, who you met, who walk through the thick bush. And when the thick bush, it's very difficult to see a leopard's fur. This is going to be very special, everyone. We're going to see these elephants having a drink. That's wonderful. We're very, very lucky today to see all these things. We don't always see such amazing things in one drive. There we go. Let's just get into a position where we can watch them nicely. That's beautiful. Look at that. What a wonderful sighting we have. We're so lucky. They're all thirsty. And elephants get very thirsty. They have to drink every single day. Same as you have to drink every single day. Well, so do the elephants. And they're very, very big, you can see. And look, they're just like us, you know. Elephants are just like us. You know how, you know, when you go to a birthday party, the boys are always fighting with each other and pushing each other all over the place. Well, it's the same with the elephants. And you know how the girls were much more civilized about life, and they talk to each other nicely, and they kind of, they don't behave, they don't push each other about. Well, it's the same with elephants. And I'll show you what I mean if they start to do silly things. It's very funny to watch. Look at that one there, trying to climb up the bank. That's a young bull. It's a young male. He's just playing. He's not actually stuck. He's just playing because he's being silly. Isn't that funny? I think that's great. There we go, he's climbed up. Beautiful sighting of elephants having a lovely drink. And it's quite hot. It's not very hot, everybody. And Lira and Fatima, you want to know how big an elephant is in real life. Well, I mean, very big. They are bigger. I don't know what kind of car your dad drives, but I'm sure some of your fathers will drive those big 4x4s like a Fortuna or a Prado. They're about the same size as a Prado. So that's a huge, huge animal, like a Land Cruiser, bigger than a Land Cruiser. And you know, an elephant is so strong that if it wanted to, it could turn one of those huge Land Cruisers or Fortunas over, push it over onto its side. And that's how big they are. They weigh 6,000 kilograms. A big male elephant weighs 6,000 kilograms. You know how heavy that is? Oh, and we've got zebras running around here. Oh, it's just wonderful. Look at that. Kilos, everybody, for a big male elephant. Now let's pretend that you will weigh 25 kilos or so, four of you per 100 kilograms, that makes 40 of you per 1,000 kilograms, which means if you multiply that by six times 40 is what? Does anybody know? That means that there would be 240 little Rhodian girl grade ones in one big elephant bull. Isn't that amazing? 240 of you. So that's how big they are. And Izzy, the baby elephant, which is the smallest one we have here. You want to know how big that one is. There are a couple there in the group there. There we go. The one just disappearing. That one is probably about 1.5 meters tall. So that's about 5 rulers tall. Isn't that impressive? 5 rulers tall and probably weighs about 250, no more, about 400 kilograms. So if we do our little analogy again, that is roughly the same as 16 of you. So though your whole class just about could fit into that tiny little elephant. Now look at the zebra, they want to come and have a drink, but they're a bit scared of the elephants because the elephants are so very big. Look at them running around. And Pierre, you want to know how much water the elephants drink. Pierre, a big bull elephant, if you can believe it, drinks more than 150 liters of water in one day. 150 liters of water. That's 150 milk bottles. Now, why do you think these zebra are running around like this? Why do you think they would be nervous? What would make elephants, at least, what would make zebra nervous? Think about where we've just come from. They can smell the lions. That's where they're looking. They're looking straight towards the lions. They can see all the vultures in the trees. They can probably smell the buffalo meat. And so they're very nervous. They know that the lions are around. There we are. The buffaloes are just down there, or the lions are just down there. And Lily, you're wondering about elephants and their tusks. They're not horns, Lily. They're teeth. So if you tap the two there, look at the lion moving. Those zebra can see that lion. But he's too far away for them, much too far away, and they're not hungry anymore, so the lions will not attack the zebras. Lily, the front of an elephant is tusks. Now if you all open your mouth and tap your front teeth, like I'm doing. So these two teeth here, those two now, the same ones that Bugs Bunny's got, those are what tusks are. They're the same teeth, and what they do is they just grow all the way out like that, out of the elephant's mouth. Now, why do you think a zebra would run towards the lions? I'll tell you why. They run towards them so that they know exactly where they are. They don't want the lions to hide from them in the bushes here and be able to sneak up on them. They want to know exactly where the lions are. This is very, very interesting, you know. We've got zebras and vultures and lions and elephants disappearing. Adrian, you want to know what elephants eat when they're born. Same thing you ate when you were born, Adrian. They eat milk. They suckle from their mums. They are mammals in the same way that you are a mammal. And so they drink milk from their mothers. And then when they're about a year or 2 years old, then they finish drinking milk and they eventually will start to eat grass. But they can suckle from their mothers up to 4 years. So much longer than human beings will suckle from their mothers. There they go, just down the hill there. We're not going to follow them. We're going to let them go gently down into the woodland. What a very special, lucky time we've had. Okay, let's go down back towards where the vultures are and see what we can see there. I think we'll just leave the elephants there. Gail, you want to know how an elephant breathes. Gail, how do you breathe? How do you breathe? Where do you get the air from? Through your nose and through your mouth. Same way that an elephant does it. Their trunks, there's a big nose, that's what that big trunk is. They can breathe through that. Otherwise, they can breathe through their mouths as well. And that's how they get their air. Same as all mammals. Some mammals can't breathe through their mouths, they can only breathe through their noses. And those zebra apparently are a good example of a mammal that is unable to breathe through the mouth. They can only breathe through the nose. And I know that some of you will ride horses, and you know that horses are the same. Okay, everybody, I believe you've got to go back to your schooling day. And thank you very much for coming on safari with Vim and I and with Byron. Byron's tracking at the moment, and I hope you have a wonderful rest of your day. And remember, I hope that you will come and visit this area one day and tell your parents you want to come to the Kruger Park and see these incredible animals for yourself. We'll say goodbye to you as you look at that vulture. Have a great day. Alrighty, let's head across to Byron for the rest of us and find out what he's doing. I don't know where to look around here anymore.
James has had all the luck this morning. We were lucky to see Karula and her cubs, but it sounds like everything's just happening around James at the moment. That's amazing. It's very, very wonderful. I'm so happy for him. And for all of you to be able to see it. Brian and I have just seen fresh male leopard tracks, trying to work out which direction they go. They head straight towards the camp. So I'm having a good look around this area. I'd love to see a big male leopard. Almost walked straight past the FC. So if that is the case and the ladies missed it, we're going to have a word with them later. just have a look here now. Where did we last see these tracks? There is the small Galago waterhole, which is not too far from us. And it's a good chance that that leopard walked right down to there to go and have a drink. Let's just have a look. Love to be able to show you this male leopard track. See if I can find a clear one. I think this was the last place we had the tracks, just back here. Yeah, let me see if I can show you clearly. Is that good? All right. Give me a second, let me get out and I will circle the track for you and show you exactly. Brian can tell me, let me just get a little stick. It's nice to circle with the stick. All right. Brian, which ones are the best? Can you see these over here? All right, there we go. So now if I can show you carefully this, and how I know that it's a big male leopard track. The track is very, very round. It's quite a nice round track and much larger than a female's track. This looks like the front paw over here. This one, very large, round front paw, and this is potentially the back paw from what it looks like to me. He's heading in this direction. As I said, he's come right up towards the camp and it looks like he's turned, maybe gone towards that Galago waterhole, which is down in this direction. Now with the leopard track, you can see a very clear W at the back. Now the big cats, the lion and the leopard, have got these clear three lobes at the back of the track, so the palm of the track. Oh dear. Can you hear me there? Is that right? Sorry, audio problems. So there's 1, 2, 3, 4 clear toe marks. And you can see that clearly in the track. So you can see he's headed down the road, all the way down the road. And I can tell it's fresh because it's very, very clear. And we drove out here this morning and there were no tracks. So I'm sure we are not too far behind him. But I think he has cut through to the Galago waterhole.
So I think, why don't we quickly head down there, we're not too far, and see if we can find it. It's very exciting. It's a lovely morning. The temperature's warmed up wonderfully. It's going to be a really, really great day. Another great day. And what a morning we've had. We've had so much activity. We've been lucky for the last 2 days. It's really been fantastic. Come on, Brian. Let's try to find this male leopard. That'd be awesome. So Marianne has asked us, occasionally when she watches on the Zoom camera, she can see mosquitoes on the leopards, and she would like to know, do they get malaria? No, Marianne, they do not, but it's probably not mosquitoes. Sorry, I just want to have a look. Those look like hyena tracks, though. Yeah, that's all right. Not far from their waterhole. So Marianne, it's probably not mosquitoes. It's little fleas or bugs, sometimes tiny little flies that bother these big cats. It's not mosquitoes. But no, these animals out here do not get malaria. Definitely not that I know of, but I'm almost certain I've never ever heard or seen of an animal dying of malaria. They obviously have different immunity to mosquito bites compared to us. But those that you can see on the camera are most likely little flies, little midges that are bothering those animals. Just keep looking very carefully through the bush while we're driving here. Never know, this male leopard could be just around the corner. While I'm searching this area, James has got some more interesting birds to show you.
There's an incredible array of vultures here, everybody. We've got the white-headed vulture. That's that one there. And that's the one we showed the kids. It's a juvenile white-headed, but it is massive. And I don't know if you're going to get the perspective here, but if you go off to the, we move to the right, you can see there the size of the hooded vulture, which is not a small bird, but it's appreciably smaller than the white-headed. And then you've got our sort of standard issue, as VM describes it, a classic vulture, the white-backed vulture there. That's the one sort of sitting on his haunches. And in the background, you can see the lions pulling that buffalo about the place. And we're going to go back to the boundary with Mala Mala, everybody, because apparently the cheetah are back in view. So while we drive along there, Greg, I'll answer your question. What is that vulture carrying, Liam? A stick.
He's playing fetch.
It's playing fetch, yes. There we go. Off you go. He's found a nice addition to his home. He's going to put that in his house. Greg, the wingspan of the white-backed vulture, if I'm not mistaken, is about 2 meters. That's about 7.5 to 8 feet. I will just check that up for you. The biggest... No, they are. Yeah, look at that. 3 different species. Oh, no, 2 different species. The white-backed sitting with the white-headed. Let me just quickly check for you, Greg, because they've all got slightly different wingspans, obviously. So the white-backed has a wingspan of 2.2 meters. So that's about, it's about 8 feet. No, 7.5 feet. Then I think the biggest one is the Cape Vulture. And the Cape Vulture has a wingspan of 2.5 meters. So what's that in feet? 2.5 meters is about 6 foot two plus another 30 or so. Now that's about 7.5 feet. 2.5 meters, 7.5 feet. So the white back that you're looking at there is, well, now you're looking at a hooded. That's probably got a wingspan of about 6 feet. The poor maligned hooded vulture. It's got to eat a lot of dung before it gets enough to eat. It doesn't, it unfortunately really does feed on the scraps. If ever there was a vulture that you wouldn't want to be, it would be a hooded vulture. A scrap eater and dung devourer. Aren't you glad you're not a dung devourer? VM, you really love this, don't you? The sight of me taking incompetent pictures makes you very happy. That was yet another one. Unusable will be deleted. Okay, let's quickly go and see if we can see those cheetah again. We don't have too much time left on the drive. Turn that off, move that out of the way, and go down. I think they've come back towards the boundary. I don't think they're on cheetah plains at the moment, but they seem to be back this, or certainly within view. Lion eating buffalo. There's so much going on here at Cheetah Plains today. I can't believe we've come down here sometimes, well, as it is everywhere in the wilderness, and we found nothing. I came down here once, I remember, we spent about 3 hours here, and we found, I think it was one wildebeest bull. That was it. Right, let's speed down into the clearings here. See if we can see our cheetah friends. Get out of the way, bird. Crowned lapwing. Hello, Susan in New York. What a lovely question. You say, have I ever had the sense that some of the animals in the park here individually recognize us individually? Susan, I have, but I don't know that if I'm being... I suspect quite strongly that I'm seeing things that aren't there. So as a biologist, I would say to you, I think it's very unlikely. But anybody who is has worked with animals for extended periods, for example, if you worked with chimpanzees, if you've worked with a dog can recognize you individually, there's no question. So I don't really see why it wouldn't be the case that the animals out here should be able, or wouldn't be able to recognize us. Well, there is Andrew. Do you see the cheetah anywhere? We're just going to look around here. Apparently they came back towards the boundary. I'm just going to get hold of Andrew quickly. Andrew, come in. Because Air didn't see them. We might have to drive back along that way. Oh, there he is. I see him. I got him now. So do elephants recognize us individually? I don't see why not. Why I say sometimes I think I'm conning myself is, you know, you see a leopard like Karula, which we, with whom we have this amazing relationship that we spend so much time with. And we like to think of her as, you know, I mean, and I've read it on some of the social media around Safari Live. People say, well, she very kindly showed her cubs to you, which is true to the extent that it was wonderful to see the cubs, but did she genuinely show them to me, or was it a case of my just being in the right place at the right time? I don't know. And would she be more likely to show her cubs to one person than another person? I don't know. I think it's unlikely. Now, I'm not sure what kind of a view we're going to have of these cheetah. There are two Mala vehicles in the sighting. We'll just wave fondly at them. It's not going to be a great sighting. It would have been better with the other camera, I'm afraid. We'll just have a quick look and then we'll start heading back towards Juma. Yeah, this is not going to be the best cheetah sighting you've ever had, but they are cheetah and it still will be decent. There we go. Very nice. Arcadia, you make a very good point. You say we always see these two cheetah brothers and we don't seem to see any others. We don't seem to see any females. And you say, well, are there no females around? I've seen one female here and she will come in and out of this area. They're not strictly territorial. But yes, you're right. The habitat is not ideal and therefore the number of cheetah will be much lower than it could be in some other areas. But there will be females that pop through here from time to time. There's a herd of wildebeest also grazing peacefully in Mala, enjoying the warmth of the morning now. The sun has come out. It's a delicious morning, I must say. Now, Mala, in case you don't know, is one of the original ecotourism, private ecotourism operations of the Sabi Sands, together with Londolozi and I think probably Lion Sands to the south. They really did pioneer ecotourism in this area, this private ecotourism that has sustained the Sabi Sand and created almost an entire industry out here. Provides countless jobs, has protected any number of hectares of land, and provided a safe haven for animals like those two cheetah that you're looking at now. And Justin, you're interested in domesticating cheetahs, or not possibly physically domesticating them, but you want to know if they can be domesticated. Justin, they can be. Apparently, I don't think it's easy, but they can be domesticated, and they have been, certainly. And I know that throughout history there have been various sort of domineering fellows of history, like Genghis Khan, for example. Apparently he had a stable of cheetah that he used to use as hunting dogs. So yes, they most certainly can be domesticated. They don't breed well in captivity, though, apparently. They're very shy about breeding in captivity, and so they're not necessarily the best candidates for conservation in captivity. All right, everybody, that's the cheetah. I don't think we're going to sit with them any longer. We're going to make our way back towards Juma slowly, and maybe we'll be very lucky on the way there. Maybe Nkanyeni will pop out. And many lion tracks up and down this road, I suspect, from those lions that we saw there. Now, those of you who are regular viewers, would you kindly give some thought to which lions those were? We think there were two Birmingham boys, but we don't know. That wasn't very friendly. He didn't wave at me at all, but his guests are waving at me. And that's funny. And I don't know which three females those were. Andries from Chitwa Chitwa said he thought they were the Talamati pride. Very far south for the Talamati pride to be. So I don't know who they were. Fascinating stuff. Okay, let's head across to Byron, get an update from him. We'll see you back at Juma.
James, you can't just lose your train of thought like that. We've lost something else, though. We've lost our leopard tracks. Can't see where they come out. They headed straight past camp. So not sure if it's in a block just between the camp and the waterhole. We did go and check Gallego waterhole or pan, but no luck, no sign anywhere around there. That's how it happens sometimes. I'm sure he's in there somewhere. We're right back in the area where, right back in the area where Karula was yesterday with that Daker kill. So, I wonder if he doesn't pick up on the scent that she was around and maybe just came to have a look and investigate. Because he came straight into this direction, into this area, but no sign of him anywhere. But male leopards have the ability to hide extremely well. Some giraffe tracks and dung around here. Let's see if we don't find a giraffe, perhaps. James is definitely having so much luck. Everything seems to be falling in his lap. I am going to mark that down to luck and not skill. See what he has to say about that later. So Mark in Chicago has asked an interesting question, and I've been touching on it a little bit. Hang on, a little hornbill. Just sitting off to the right, red-billed hornbill. Look at that beautiful bird. He was running around on the ground. He's just jumped off, and he's on the ground there. Watch them run. That was so funny, picking up little seeds. Also feed on insects. Beautiful bird, the red-billed hornbill. So Mark, getting back to your question, Mark has asked, generally, how close can we get to an animal without it feeling threatened or being threatened? So Mark, I think it varies from animal to animal. It also varies on the area that you are in. And I say that because in some areas, where animals have been hunted in the past, perhaps they are a little bit more nervous of vehicles and people, so it takes them a lot longer to become relaxed, and they will move off quite quickly if they do hear or see any vehicles. You won't be able to get close to them. But animals in these areas, even within the greater Kruger, it does take time to get them habituated to vehicles. It doesn't just happen overnight, and new lions could come into the area and they may be a little bit more skittish, so you don't get that close, so they will feel threatened from a further distance, not necessarily threatened but also a bit nervous, and then choose to move off. So it depends on the animals, it depends where they have been or where they're going or how long they've been in an area that they have seen vehicles. Then they may get a little bit more relaxed a lot sooner. Animals like impala and other antelope species tend to be wary and just try and keep their distance. But like you saw this morning, we had that beautiful female leopard. We got really close to her and she got up and moved off right past the vehicle, and she was not fazed by us at all. But she's a 12, 13-year-old leopard that's very comfortable with the vehicle. She's been viewed for many years. So she knows that we are no threat or danger, and that is the key. It's just to make sure that these animals know there's no threat or danger, and if they feel comfortable with that, then that you find you can get a lot closer to them than usual. This hornbill is looking for food. Just carry on scratching. It's incredible. Beautiful bird. This is the area we had those big male lions last night. They were lying down right here and had that beautiful roar for us at the end of the show yesterday. What a way to end. We were so lucky. We sat there for a long time and we waited and waited and waited. And our patience paid off. We got to hear them roar. Lex, do you copy Lex? Large bird of prey flying above us. Let me see, perhaps Brian can get it for you. You see there, Brian? Looks like a vulture, and it is a vulture, and it looks like and is a white-backed vulture. It is a white-backed vulture. So often people see vultures flying around, and they think, oh, there must be a kill. There's got to be a kill. That's not always the case. So, if you, just to give you a bit of perspective of where it's flying, but it's drifting quite a bit from where I first saw it to where it is now. And what is happening here is the vulture has picked up the thermals. The day is starting to warm up and all the hot air is beginning to rise. And these thermals allow these vultures to soar and drift and look for food. They have incredible eyesight. They can spot something roughly around the size of an A4 piece of paper from about 2 kilometers away up in the air. It's incredible how good their eyesight is. So now the morning is starting to warm up. The vultures are able to catch these thermals, so they conserve the energy with their flight. They're able to circle up and soar and then hopefully find some food a little bit later. Now, this vulture, if it continues to fly around, it may see other vultures going into that area where James is. There is a lot of vulture activity around there with that lion kill on the buffalo. And then it may join up to them. I've seen vultures come from all over. You don't see a single vulture in the sky. And the next thing, they all arrive when they start finding a carcass. And as soon as one or two start heading in, the rest follow them. And they all come into that area to get some food and try and scavenge off of a carcass. Lovely. It's drifted off quite away now. Speaking about James and the carcass that he saw this morning, let's get an update from him and see what he is up to.
Baron, of course, is completely correct. We have had all the luck today, and I'd love to say it was skill. I'd love to tell you that it was my great foresight that brought us to Cheetah Plains this morning, but it had nothing to do with that. It was entirely on a whim. And so, yes, thank you to luck, the universe, whatever deity it is that you might choose to be grateful to, whoever it is has blessed us richly this morning. It's been really lovely. Viam and I were just wondering what happened to those dogs yesterday and wondering if they'd been called in. I wonder if they're not on Biffle's Hook, perhaps. They would definitely be a long way from us. And I wonder, too, if you've had any thoughts on who those lions were. Pretty sure there were two Birmingham boys. We had the other two yesterday, one of them on Chitwa Chitwa today, the other one... are those three lionesses. There were three of them that killed a buffalo the other day on, well, three lionesses killed a buffalo about 4 days ago, 5 days ago, on, maybe they're the same ones.
Well, so James has just been lost there. Not sure which area he's driving through. He's still on Cheetah Plains. Signal comes and goes a little bit the further away from camp we are. But luckily, there are two of us. So if one does go down, the other one is always around. And hopefully has something to show you. At the moment, I've got nothing. I haven't had as much luck as James has had this morning. But it happens like it. Oh, I say that. But you know what? We were very lucky this morning. We got to see a female leopard and her two cubs. That's incredibly lucky. So we must never take our sightings for granted. It's really nice just cruising through the bush now, seeing what we can bump into. You never know. There's signs of elephant around, but I haven't. We saw some earlier, but just as we got those leopard tracks, Brian and I thought, you know what, these leopard tracks are fresh. Let's try and follow them. And I do believe they are fresh. They're definitely from this morning. But unfortunately, it's moved into an area that was quite thick. A lot of drainage lines. Not too sure. We thought he went to the waterhole, but didn't see anything coming out. I looked around, no sign of him drinking, so not too sure where that male leopard is hiding. And a big hello to Andre, Denise and Shireen down in the Eastern Cape. Now, they say they've been watching the show quite a bit and really enjoying it. I hope so, and I hope they have enjoyed it as much as I have. It's been great. And they say a lot of them, they've been watching it before work in the mornings. And I know some people are watching while they are at work, and that's great. If you've got the opportunity to do that, that's very lucky and that's fantastic. Help you get through a day. So Bud in North Carolina has asked us, when, as the dry season continues and begins to worsen, what other animals are we able or likely to see show up on the plains of Arethusa or Juma or Cheetah Plains? So Bud, best way to describe it, and let me just stop in the shade so I can explain it nicely to you, but these areas, The animals are here throughout the year, so they're constantly moving around. It doesn't matter whether it's summer or winter. The only real difference is in summer, the bush is a lot thicker. It's very lush, it's very green, because summer is our rainfall season. So we tend to get a lot more rainfall and everything grows and it's very, very beautiful. The winter, all that happens is the bush begins to thin out slightly. So it might be easier to spot some of the animals. We don't have migrations in southern Africa. So the animals are always around. There's always a little bit of water, enough to get them through, hopefully, through the dry season. So you're not going to necessarily see different animals just showing up because it's a drier season or because it's a summer season. The only thing that will change is the bird life. And the reason for that is, in summer, we have a lot more rainfall and it's a lot warmer. So you get birds from northern Africa or Europe migrating south and enjoying the summer time down here with us. And then in our winter, they migrate north again, back to north central Africa or some up to Europe. So those birds, sorry, I've got flies buzzing around. Those birds would change, the bird species and that. But in terms of animal movements, the animals are always around here. These areas, they do not move out in and out of the area completely. So you're not going to see different animals at different times of the year. It might just be easier to spot some of the animals in winter because it is a little bit more open. So James Richard has asked me what my favorite sighting has been this week. What have I enjoyed the most and what else I would like to still see before I leave Safari Live. And James Richard, I'm trying to think now. I mean, sure. It's always wonderful to see lions and hear them roar so close to the vehicle. I really enjoyed last night. That's one of my favorite. But I think this morning, that female leopard with her two cubs, it's so special to be able to see that. I really can't tell you how lucky we are. It's not something you see often. And to be able to see Karula and her two cubs, for me, was definitely a highlight. What else? You know, but we've seen a lot of interesting things. The giant eagle owls that we saw, that was great. That was very different. We saw, what else did we see? We've seen so much. The cheetah the other day, that was nice and a great surprise. So, yeah, but I'd have to say the leopard this morning with the two cubs, that was really, really great. But also, now that I think about it, the elephant, the amount of elephant around has been fantastic. I love elephant, love spending time with them. And the elephant in this area have been very relaxed with us being around. We've got to see all the youngsters. It's been incredible. I would like to see a big dominant male leopard before we go. And it looked like those tracks we had this morning were of one. So I may, when we get back to camp, I may just head out and go and walk through an area and see if I can't track and find exactly where he's gone. And we might be able to show you that this afternoon. But that would be great. That would be something that I'd love to see before I leave here. But then from here, I just head south to Londolozi. I'm guiding guests there for a few days. And then I'm staying and helping there for a short while before I head back to Johannesburg. So I've still got a long period of time in the bush, which I'm looking forward to, guiding different people from all over. And that is something I really, really enjoy. And that's why I love doing what I do. But Safari Live has been great and all the support and questions and the fun that we've had. We've had so much fun. James and I, we really have enjoyed having each other around. I think, well, I speak for myself then. I've enjoyed having James around us as a colleague on the vehicles. I'm not sure what he would say. Oh, we've got some impala just running off. A young male and a female. Beautiful antelope. Almost like they tiptoe through the bush. Wonderful to see them. And this morning the impala helped us find Karula. They were the ones that were alarm calling and alerted us to which area she was in. We didn't have an idea. We were looking around, trying to see if we can't find any sign of her or tracks of her. And we didn't have any luck until they started alarm calling. And that's how we found her this morning. And Tammy Peterson, thank you very much for your comment saying I fit right into the Wild Earth family. I hope so. It's been great, and it's really fantastic to be able to come out and help for a short while the other guides get a bit of a break. And I'm sure I will be back in the future. It's a wonderful concept. I think the Wild Earth, being able to showcase nature to people all around the world that haven't had the opportunity to get out here themselves yet. Some have been out and on safari, and they still watch and they're still loving, enjoying it with us. But hopefully this just sparks that interest even further and gets more people to come out and visit. It's a wonderful, wonderful experience to be able to be out here, go on a safari and see the animals for yourself, you know, up close and personal. Aqua has asked, do I have two or three drives left with you? So I have this afternoon's drive and then tomorrow morning. So two more drives with all of you. And I will miss all of you too. I'll miss the questions and and the banter on the vehicle. It's been great. And it's also so nice to be driving around with these great cameramen. Every day or every drive it's with a different cameraman. But Brian, VM and David have been amazing. It's great having them around. It's incredible to see what they do with the camera. I mean, you know, I could never do that. So the way they zoom in and follow the animals and find animals through thickets is incredible. And as I pass this herd of impala off to our left, thank you very much for this morning. I hope you have all enjoyed it as much as I have. Cross over to James that he may say goodbye. Thank you to Brian and the thumb. It was great, really great morning. And we'll see you this afternoon again. Don't forget to tune in and send us your questions. Off to James and his goodbye.
What's he going to say when it's actually his last drive? I mean, goodness gracious me. I'm very glad he's had a good time here and is continuing to have a good time here and will continue to do so for the next two drives. It has been great fun having Byron here. I will get on to that actually on his last drive, though not now. We're back on Juma. We drove here at great speed. One, because we didn't have signal. And secondly, because Viam and I are now desperately hungry, aren't we, Viam? And I think it's a fry-up today, isn't it? Yes. Just depends how much there is left. The shopping trip arrives today, everyone. We might be on to bland cereals this morning with one or two pieces of stale bread and maybe a bit of water heated. We could fry the cereal. Did we?
We had a fried up cereal cake or something.
Oh, yes. Okay, maybe we could fry some cereal. That would be delicious. As long as I'm not involved. I'm the world's worst wildlife photographer, but I'm pretty close to being the world's worst cook as well. In fact, I'm a worse cook than I am photographer, and that really does say something. Hello, Judy H. You say, is my microphone under my hat, or is this just a giant black chorb? You actually didn't say that. You said, or did someone clobber me? Judy H., while there's unquestionably cause for many people to give me a clobbering in this area, no, that is my microphone. And what it means is that I can do this and the sound doesn't change. I can ruffle my jacket and the sound doesn't change. And also, my stomach can make those very loud grumbling sounds that it tends to make this time of the day, and there is no change. And so I'm going to continue wearing it underneath my hat. Right, that's going to be it from us this morning. Some impala up ahead is your last dawn safari sunrise. Dawn safari animal. A big thank you to Viam on the mail, well done. And a big thank you to Rebecca and Louise in the final control. And of course, to Byron and Brian on the other car. We'll see you later today at 3:30. Stay safe and happy until then.